friends, today I'm coming at you with another career roadmap. You all really seemed to like my environmental scientist versus engineer video, so I thought I would help those of you out who are interested in pursuing a career in environmental engineering and lay out a step-by-step framework to landing a job as an environmental engineer. As some of you may know from my career journey video, my original plan was to become an environmental engineer, and after taking a few classes during my undergraduate degree, I decided that it wasn't for me and then switched to environmental science. So I've taken some tips and tricks from what my advisors told me during that time and updated that with industry trends and market advice right now. So hopefully it will give you the whole picture and give you a better idea of what is required to become an environmental engineer. I have linked all the sources I used down below in the description. And if you have your own advice for how to become an engineer, I would love to hear about it in the comments down below. So what can you expect in this video? First, we're going to cover the basics of environmental engineers. Then we'll cover what educational requirements you might need. We'll talk about important skills and how to network in the engineering field. And then we'll wrap it up with actually landing that job. So if you are in high school or college and are considering becoming an environmental engineer, you are in the right place. I got you covered. So let's dig into it. First, we'll cover the basics. What does an environmental engineer actually do? They work on projects primarily to protect and improve the environment. Oftentimes, this means reducing the pollution of a designated area, and they'll often specifically focus on water pollution or air pollution. They might also be contracted out to individual companies and advise those companies on how to have more sustainable solutions within the business practice. And if you're lucky, you'll get to work on managing waste all the way from the toilet to the ocean. If you're catching my drift. Whatever you're working on as an environmental engineer, it's a field that is very important to our fight against the climate crisis. And from the day to day, it offers a lot of opportunities and variety in your tasks. Most positions get to work both in the field and in an office setting, but let's get into the actual hard facts on the industry outlook for environmental engineers. In 2023, their median pay was $100,090. The number of jobs in 2022 was 47,300. Jobs, and the job outlook over the 10 years between 2022 and 2023 is 6%, which is faster than average, but is actually the same job outlook as environmental scientists, which is interesting. So if that all sounds interesting to you, how do you actually become an environmental engineer? Well, if you are a high school student, the next step for you would be to pursue a four-year degree in engineering. If you are in high school, it would be a good idea to focus on courses like math, chemistry, biology, and physics, those hard sciences, just to prepare you for your courses that you will take when you get to college. You will also want to start applying to bachelor's degree programs around your junior year of high school. And the majors that you might want to take a look at are environmental engineering, if the school has it. If they don't, you can also opt for civil engineering, chemical engineering, or something along those lines. If you take a look at the actual course requirements for that major, really keep an eye out for courses that focus on water resources, any environmental or ecological systems, and sustainable practices as a whole. And make sure to do your research and that the program that you're looking at is accredited by the Accreditation Board of Engineering and Technology, just to make sure you're in the right place. Now, if you're already in college, but you didn't choose one of those majors, have no fear, you can still transition to one of those majors or start to take classes that line up with the course loads in those majors. It might just take you a little extra time, money, and energy to make that transition, but it is totally possible. If you already are in one of these majors, the next step would be to pursue internships and hands-on experience to further enhance your undergraduate degree. You want to look for any type of internship that directly applies what you're learning in your classes to the actual field. A lot of these are research projects with professors, and you might also find really valuable internships with local governments or NGOs. Now, while you are in school and pursuing those internships and doing great in your classes, I do have a few tips to fully optimize your college experience. The first is to engage in some sort of research activity, whether that is in the classroom or outside of the classroom with a professor together in a lab. Having that hands-on experience will not only boost your resume, as we all know, but it will also help you solidify the concepts that you've learned in the classroom so that you can carry them out of your bachelor's degree and into the actual field. I would also recommend getting involved in campus clubs and organizations. There are plenty of nationwide clubs in engineering that provide some great career development experience. I know at the school that I went to, we had a ton of clubs for engineers. There was the Engineers Without Borders, which is really great if you're interested in service and also traveling. There is the Society of Women Engineers, which does provide a great support group if you are a woman in STEM. There's the American Society of Civil Engineers, and there are professional co-ed fraternities that you can join if you want more of a social aspect. These clubs and organizations are such a good way to expand your network, learn about different research opportunities, and just get more involved in the environmental engineering space. So I would highly, highly recommend if you are a current college student and want to get a little more involved. The last tip is to stay current with your knowledge of the field. Just because you're watching this video is a great first step because it means you're seeking external content related to your career. But don't stop here. I would encourage you to pursue other YouTube videos, but also podcasts, news articles, and even documentaries that can inform you what's going on in the broader field of environmental engineering and the state of the climate in general. All right, hopefully that gave you an idea of how to make the most out of your undergraduate degree in environmental engineering while you are killing your classes, getting into those research opportunities, and joining clubs and organizations. There are some skills that you'll want to focus on developing along the way. And there are four primary categories of skills that you'll want to focus your effort on. They are technical skills, problem-solving skills, communication skills, and collaboration skills. So the first one is technical, and you'll learn most of these skills in your class. You will want to develop a very strong knowledge in environmental science and engineering principles. You'll also want to develop skills with different softwares like CAD. You'll want to get a good handle on data analysis and visualization and learn about different engineering regulations. Problem-solving skills will also likely be covered in your classes if they are good classes. This one's all about thinking outside the box and developing innovative solutions to engineering problems. The third category is communication, and honestly, you're going to need this skill for any job that we talk about on this channel, but any field in the environmental or sustainability realm will require a high level of communication with many different stakeholders because it is such a hot topic. You're going to want skills in writing reports, presenting your findings on different research topics, and making sure that you have clear and effective communication, again, with different stakeholders who might have differing opinions. And the last skill set is collaboration. Most of your projects post-grad will involve some level of teamwork and collaboration with other engineers at your level, but also with your managers and program supervisors. On the note of collaboration, a great way to practice the skills of effective communication and collaboration is through networking. Networking is going to be the key step in landing a job after graduation. To build your professional network, not only will you want to do well in classes and join those clubs and organizations on campus, but you might also want to, if the opportunity presents itself, attend industry conferences and events. So I know at least the lab I did research in during my undergraduate degree, I did have the opportunity to present at a GU conference, which is the American Geophysical Union, and that led to some really great networking opportunities. Not only can you learn a lot from the different panels at those conferences, but you can also network and meet some really interesting people that might end up having an opening on their team. Another part of networking is making sure that your LinkedIn is up to date. As much as you might want to deny it, your internet presence does matter, and hiring managers and other professionals in the field will look at your LinkedIn profile to see what kind of skills you have, what experience you have, what school you went to, etc. So you want to make sure that that is up to date and looking professional. The last thing I'll say about networking is that mentorship is crucial. You'll want to find at least one mentor that you can work with throughout your entire undergraduate degree that can answer any questions that you have that you can feel comfortable going to with different issues that you're having in your classes or in your internship opportunities. This mentor can also help you secure those internship opportunities. Maybe they are your manager at your internship or a professor. They can offer incredible guidance and some really valuable advice as you are making your way through your undergraduate degree and start to look at post-grad opportunities. That leads us to the last step, which is actually landing and securing that job post-graduation. Now, environmental engineering is a special profession in this field in that it's one of the only ones that doesn't necessarily require further education to land a decently paying job with opportunities for management. So you might want to start looking for jobs around your senior year in college. For environmental engineers, I would recommend starting the job search in January, and then you may expect an offer anytime between March and May of that year. When you are starting your job search, the first place you should go is not LinkedIn Jobs or Indeed. It is your mentor that you've been working with all throughout college. You'll want to ask them first if they know of any openings that you specifically would do well in. And then if that comes up dry, you can also expand that search to your network. So those clubs and organizations you've joined, you can reach out to the advisors of those clubs, but also alumni of those clubs and see if they have any openings available for you specifically. Once you actually have reached out to your network, then it's time to start getting to work on your resume and your cover letter, tailoring those two things towards specific jobs and preparing for those interviews. If you start early and are building your network all 4 years, you will be absolutely golden. So folks, there you have it, your roadmap to becoming an environmental engineer. It is a pretty challenging but incredibly rewarding field to be in. If you have any other questions about the roadmap or the field, or if you're an environmental engineer and want to shed your own wisdom on becoming an environmental engineer, please drop a comment down below. Don't forget to like this video, subscribe to the channel if you're not already, and hit that notification bell so you don't miss the next video. If you're still not sure if environmental engineering is the right choice for you, go check out my environmental scientist versus environmental engineers video where I compare the two fields and share a little bit about why I did not choose environmental engineering. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Bye.